Hello again, guys, and welcome back to our CHE211 lecture pod. In this video, we will discuss the quantitative applications of redox titrations. These are the learning outcomes for this lecture. So after watching this video, you must be able to discuss the general principles of redox titrations, enumerate ways on how we can adjust the oxidation states of our analyte, enumerate some auxiliary oxidizing and reducing agents, discuss the use, the preparation, the advantages and disadvantages of bromometry, cerimetry, dichrometry, iodometry, and permanganometry. And lastly, you must be able to calculate quantitative redox titration-related applications. In this lecture, we will look at the general applications of redox titrimetry with an emphasis on environmental, pharmaceutical, and industrial applications. We begin with a brief discussion of the general principles of redox titration, and then we will look into how we can control the analyte's oxidation state. Okay, so the first important principle for a successful redox titration is that the analyte to be titrated must be in a definite oxidation state. Sometimes it is necessary to carry out preliminary chemical treatments, and I will discuss these chemical pretreatments in the succeeding slides. The second principle is that redox reactions that occurs during titration must be quantitative, so this means the reactions needs to proceed to completion. The third principle is that for a direct titration, the oxidation reactions must be quite fast, because some oxidation reactions are very slow. In case we have a slow redox reaction, direct titration is not the best choice to carry out the analysis. Instead, we perform an indirect titration. During an indirect titration, a measured excess of the standard oxidizing solution is added to the sample, and sufficient time is allowed for the reaction to be complete. Now, the excess of the oxidizing chemical is then back titrated by a standard reducing agent that reacts rapidly with the oxidant. We shall see some examples of indirect titrations in this lecture video. Lastly, there must be a good way to detect the endpoint in a redox titration. We can use visible indicators which signal the endpoint by a distinct color change. Another method for locating redox titration endpoints is the use of potentiometric titration, in which we can monitor the change in the potential while we add the titrant to the analyte. Now, the endpoint is found by examining visually the titration curve. There are three types of indicators that are used to signal redox titration's endpoint. The first classifications of redox indicators include titrants being self-indicators. A popular example of this type is the potassium permanganate titrant. The oxidized and reduced forms of the permanganate have different colors. A solution of permanganate is intensely purple. In acidic solution, however, permanganate's reduced form, that is manganous, is nearly colorless. If you look closely at these photos, when using permanganate as a titrant, the analyte solution remains colorless until the equivalence point. However, the first drop of excess permanganate produces the permanent tinge of purple, signaling the endpoint of titration. The second classification of redox indicators are compounds that form a colored compound with specific oxidized or reduced form of the titrant or the analyte. Starch, for example, forms a dark purple complex with triiodide ions. We can use this distinct color to signal the presence of excess triiodide as titrant, that is, a change in color from colorless to purple. Another example of a specific indicator is a thiocyanate, which forms a soluble red-colored complex of iron thiocyanate in the presence of iron. The most important class of indicators are substances that do not participate in the redox titration, but whose oxidized and reduced forms differ in color. When we add a redox indicator to an analyte solution, the indicator imparts a color that depends on the solution's potential. As the solution's potential changes with the addition of the titrant, the indicator eventually changes in oxidation state, and the color changes, signaling the endpoint. Alright, so this table shows the list of redox indicators whose oxidized and reduced forms are different in color. Now let us look on how we can adjust the oxidation state of the analyte before a redox titration. Remember, if a redox titration is to be used in a quantitative analysis, the analyte initially must be present in a single oxidation state. For example, iron is determined by a redox titration in which cerium-4 oxidizes iron-2 to iron-3. Depending on the sample and the method of preparation, iron initially may be present in both the positive 2 or the positive 3 oxidation states. Before titrating our solution, we must reduce any iron-3 to iron-2 if we want to determine the total concentration of iron in the sample. In any redox titration, adjusting the oxidation states of the analyte can be accomplished by pretreatment using auxiliary reducing agent or auxiliary oxidizing agents. Auxiliary reducing agents are used to ensure that the analyte oxidation states are in the reduced states. Usually, a metal that is easy to oxidize, such as zinc, aluminum, and silver, can serve as an auxiliary reducing agent. Before the titration, the metal, as a coiled wire or a powder, is added to the sample where it reduces the analyte. It is expected that any unreacted auxiliary reducing agent will react with the titrant. Therefore, it is removed before we begin the titration by removing the coiled wire or by filtration. An alternative method for using an auxiliary reducing agent is to immobilize it in a column as shown in the right-hand image. These are called reduction columns. Now, to prepare a reduction column, an aqueous slurry of the finely divided metal is packed in a glass tube equipped with a porous plug at the bottom. The sample is placed at the top of the column and moves through the column under the influence of gravity or by vacuum suction. Take note that the length of the reduction column and the flow rate are selected to ensure the analyte's complete reduction. There are two common reduction columns that are used in redox titrimetry. In the Jones reductor, the column is filled with amalgamated zinc, that is zinc-mercury amalgam, in which it is prepared by briefly placing zinc granules in a solution of mercuric chloride. The oxidation of zinc, as shown in this reaction, provides an electron for reducing the analyte. In the Walden reductor, the column is filled with granular silver metal. The solution containing the analyte is acidified with hydrochloric acid and passed through the column, where the oxidation of the silver provides necessary electrons for reducing the analyte. So this table provides a summary of the several applications of the reduction columns. You can pause this video and study the examples listed in this table. Alright, in the previous slides, we discussed how we can reduce the oxidation states of the analyte prior to the redox titration. Let us now look at how we can oxidize the analyte using our auxiliary oxidizing agent. Several reagents are used as auxiliary oxidizing agents, including ammonium peroxidized sulfate and hydrogen peroxide. Now, peroxidized sulfate is a powerful oxidizing agent that is capable of oxidizing your manganese or your Mn2+ to permanganate, your chromium-3+ to dichromate, and your cerium-3+ to cerium-4+ ions. Excess peroxidized sulfate is destroyed by briefly boiling the solution prior to titration. The reduction of hydrogen peroxide in acidic solution as shown in this chemical equation, this provides another method for oxidizing an analyte. Now, excess hydrogen peroxide can be also destroyed by briefly boiling the solution. Sodium bismuthate is another powerful agent. The half reaction for the reduction of sodium bismuthate is shown in this slide. Shown in this slide are the different reducing agents that we can use in redox titration. Again, you can pause this video and have a look at the list. Thiosulfate ion is a moderately strong reducing agent that has been widely used to determine oxidizing agents by indirect procedure that involves iodine as an enthermitate. The titration of iodine against sodium thiosulfate with starch as an indicator is one of the most accurate volumetric processes. The fundamental reaction is with triiodide. Thiosulfate is oxidized quantitatively to tetrathionate ion according to the half reaction shown here. Solutions of thiosulfate are prepared using sodium thiosulfate pentahydrate and are standardized before use. The standardization of thiosulfate is accomplished by dissolving a carefully weighed portion of the primary standard, which is potassium iodate, in an acidic solution containing an excess of potassium iodide, or Ki. Now, the reaction between the iodate and the iodide is shown here. This reaction liberates a stoichiometric amount of the triiodide. By titrating the triiodide with thiosulfate solution using a starch as a visual indicator, we can therefore determine the concentration of the thiosulfate in the titrant. Titration involving iodine commonly used as a starch suspension as an indicator. This suspension is a watery solution of starch. The starch indicator solution is added with a few drops of bactericide to prevent decomposition, as this would stop the starch behaving as an indicator. Starch is a mixture of two polymers, namely amylose and amylopectin. Amylose is a linear polysaccharide composed entirely of the glucose units. Now, experimental evidence indicates that amylose is not a straight chain of glucose units, but instead it is coiled like a spring with six glucose monomers per turn, as shown in the right-hand photo in this slide. When coiled in this fashion, amylose has just enough room in its core to accommodate an iodine molecule. So once the bond between the iodine and the helical chain of the amylose is formed, it turns an intense blue color. Only iodine element in the presence of iodide ion will give this characteristic blue-black color. Neither iodine element alone nor iodide ions alone will give the characteristic color. Although thiosulfate is one of the few reducing titrants that is not readily oxidized by contact with air, it is subject to a slow decomposition to bisulfite and elemental sulfur. If used over a period of several weeks, a solution of thiosulfate needs to be re-standardized. Several forms of bacteria are able to metabolize thiosulfate, which leads to a change in its concentration. Now, this problem is minimized by adding a preservative such as mercuric iodide to a solution of thiosulfate. Another useful reducing titrant is the ferrous ammonium sulfate hexahydrate, in which the iron present in this compound is in a positive 2 oxidation state. Now, a solution of iron 2 or ferrous is susceptible to air oxidation, but when prepared in 0.5 molar sulfuric acid, it remains stable for as long as a month. Periodic re-standardization with potassium dichromate is also advisable. Okay, so in redox titration, the titrant's concentration must remain stable during the analysis. Because a titrant in a reduced state is susceptible to air oxidation, then we expect that most redox titrations are carried out using oxidizing agents as a titrant. There are several common oxidizing titrants. Now, the use of a specific oxidizing agent as a titrant are given special names. For example, permanganometry uses potassium permanganate. Cerimetry employs cerium 4 salts. Dichrometry uses potassium dichromate, iodimetry uses iodine, and bromometry uses bromine as a titrant. Okay, so for the rest of this lecture video, we will discuss the important reactions, the advantages and disadvantages, and the application of this type of redox titration. Shown in this slide is a table that summarizes the common oxidizing redox titrants and the other useful information for each type of titration. Again, you can pause this video and study this table. Permanganometry involves the titration of the analyte with potassium permanganate solution. Potassium permanganate is probably the most widely used of all volumetric oxidizing agents. In most cases, permanganometry is performed in a very acidic solution in which the following reaction occurs as shown in this slide. Take note that the standard potential of this electrochemical reaction under this condition is positive 1.51 volts. The potassium permanganate is a powerful oxidant and readily available at moderate cost. The intense color of the permanganate ion is sufficient to detect the endpoint in most titration. Now, as I previously mentioned, potassium permanganate can serve as its own indicator. The intensely purple permanganate ion serves as its own indicator since its reduced form, which is the manganose or the Mn2+, is almost colorless. Standardization of potassium permanganate solutions is accomplished against a primary standard reducing agent such as sodium oxalate, arsenic oxide, or Fe2+, which is prepared from iron wire. Now, the respective reactions are shown in this slide. Aqueous solutions of potassium permanganate are not stable due to its ability to oxidize water in strongly acidic solutions, as shown in this reaction. This reaction is catalyzed by the presence of manganese dioxide, the manganese ion, heat, light, and the presence of other acids and bases. A moderately stable solution of permanganate is prepared by boiling it for an hour and filtering it through a sintered glass filter to remove any solid manganese dioxide that precipitates. A solution of potassium permanganate can be stable for up to 1 to 2 weeks, although you should recheck the concentration of the titrant by periodic standardization. Alright, so the following are the advantages of using potassium permanganate as a titrant. First, the titration can be done or carried out without any indicator. There is also a possibility of using it over a wide interval of pH. Permanganometry is known to have a high value of standard potential. And lastly, potassium permanganate is a cheap and accessible reagent. Now let's look at the disadvantages of permanganometry. Commercial potassium permanganate is not sufficiently pure for direct weighing as a standard. On this account, a solution of potassium permanganate is prepared at approximately correct concentration. After removal of the substance that can induce decomposition, it is standardized by titrating a substance of known purity. Hence, potassium permanganate are considered to be secondary solutions. Potassium permanganate solutions are also unstable in water. It is also impossible to titrate in the presence of chloride ions because permanganate ion can oxidize your chloride into a toxic chlorine gas. The preparation of potassium permanganate solutions also involves heating. And lastly, the strict keeping of conditions describing the technique is also a disadvantage of permanganometry. Alright, so the second type of redox titration we'll look at is cerimetry. Cerimetry, or also known as cerimetric titration, uses a positive 4-valent cerium salt as oxidizing titrants. The standard cell potential varies considerably under varying conditions of acid solutions as shown here. The ceric solutions are usually prepared from analytically useful cerium 4 compounds such as ammonium hexanitrato cerate, which gives a bright yellow solution. Cerium 4 solutions are stable even at higher temperature. In addition, these solutions have other advantages over permanganate solutions. For example, chloride ions at ordinary concentrations are not oxidized. Another advantage is that cerium 4 salts have only one possible change in oxidation number, namely from the positive 4 to the positive 3 as shown in this reaction. Cerous ions or cerium positive 3 are colorless, then certain titrations can be made with ceric solutions serving as its own indicator. However, the intensity of the yellow color of ceric ions in dilute solutions are not great. It is better to use an internal indicator in this case. Now, the useful indicators are ferroin and sodium salt of diphenylamine, whose structures are shown in this slide. Another important information that we need to know about cerimetry is that ceric solutions are normally standardized against sodium oxalate and ferrous ammonium sulfate. Another important redox titrant is potassium dichromate. As an oxidant, dichromate has advantages over permanganate, but it is less powerful. That is why its use is much more limited. Now, solid potassium dichromate is obtainable in a state of high purity and can be used as a primary standard solutions of dichromate in water. Now, the half reaction of dichromate is shown here, and this has a standard potential of 1.36 volts. The most important application of dichromate is in its reaction with iron 2, in which it is more often preferred than permanganate. Remember that only one electron is necessary to reduce iron 3 to iron 2. You can verify this when you write the reaction. The reaction for the dichromate and ferrous ion is shown here. In this reaction, dichromate ions reduces 2 moles of chromium ions, and this reaction requires 6 electrons and 14 hydrogen ions. Therefore, 1 mole of dichromate, which is the oxidizing agent, reacts with 6 moles of the ferrous, or Fe2+, which is the reducing agent, to form 6 moles of the ferric ion, or the Fe3+, and 2 moles of the chromium3+ ion. The 1:6 ratio with respect to the amounts of the dichromate and ferrous consumed will provide the stoichiometric basis of all calculations in the following example and in the self-assessment questions. Alright, so the following are the advantages of using potassium dichromate in redox titrations. As I have previously mentioned, potassium dichromate can be obtained commercially in sufficiently high purity. Therefore, potassium dichromate can be a primary standard solution. Potassium dichromate solutions are also more stable than permanganate solutions. We can also perform dichrometry even in the presence of chloride ions. Dichromate ions can oxidize a number of organic compounds, but it reacts slowly. So this may minimize potential interference caused by organic compounds during an actual inorganic analysis using dichrometry. And lastly, dichromate processes can be carried out without heating. Okay, so just like any other type of redox titrations, dichrometry also has its limitations. First, the potassium dichromate is a weaker oxidizing agent than permanganate. We also expect slower rates of reactions in dichrometry, and because of this, we often perform back titrations. Okay, let's look at a typical problem in dichrometry. The amount of uranium in an ore is determined by indirect titration. The analysis is accomplished by dissolving the ore in sulfuric acid and reducing the uranyl ion to uranium-4+ with a Walden reductor. The solution is treated with excess ferric, forming ferrous and uranium-6+. The ferrous is titrated with standard solution of potassium dichromate. In a typical analysis, a 0.315-gram sample of ore is passed through the Walden reductor and treated with 50.0 mL of 0.0125 molar ferric ion. Back titrating with 0.0987 molar potassium dichromate requires 10.52 mL. What is the percent weight by weight uranium in the sample? So you are also given the reactions in this slide. Okay, so before we carry out with our calculations, let me just point out some important things that we need to remember. In this indirect titration, iron in the form of Fe3+ reacts with the analyte uranium-4+, and then Fe2+ or the ferrous reacts with the titan potassium dichromate. In the first reaction, iron 3+ gains one electron as it is reduced to ferrous or Fe2+. And the uranium loses two electrons as it is oxidized from uranium-4+ to uranium-6+, which is the uranyl ion. Thus, each mole of uranium-4+ produces 2 moles of ferrous ion. In the second reaction, ferrous or iron-2+ loses one electron as it is oxidized to ferric or Fe3+, and each chromium gains 3 electrons as it is reduced from dichromate to chromium-3+. Thus, the stoichiometry of titration requires that 6 moles of ferrous reacts with each mole of the dichromate. Now we are ready to perform our calculations. First, the titration of the dichromate shows us that the moles of the ferrous formed using the Walden reductor is equal to 6.23 times 10 raised to negative 4 moles of the ferrous ion. So this means that the original sample must contain 3.12 times 10 raised to negative 4 moles of the uranium-4+, as shown in this simple stoichiometric relationship. Finally, the concentration of uranium in the original sample is therefore 23.6% weight by weight of uranium-4+. Another type of redox titration is iodometry. This is used to determine the concentration of oxidizing agents through an indirect process involving iodine as an intermediary. In comparison to permanganate, cerium-4, and dichromate, iodine is a weak oxidizing agent and is useful only for the analysis of analytes that are strong reducing agents. Solutions are usually prepared by adding excess iodide to form the triiodide complex. The iodide ions are added to increase the solubility of iodine in water and form the triiodide complex as shown in this reaction. Solutions of the triiodide are normally standardized against sodium thiosulfate, as we have discussed previously, using starch as a specific indicator for the triiodide. Now, this table shows some of the applications of titrations using iodine solutions. There are some important considerations for iodometry. Iodometric titration needs to be done or carried out in a weak acid environment. First, the iodine solutions used needs to be at a pH less than 8.5 because at basic pH, iodine tends to disproportionate. So disproportionation reactions are a particular kind of oxidation reduction reactions in which one of the substance is oxidized and the other one is reduced. Sodium thiosulfate needs a neutral or weak acid environment to oxidize a tetrathionate. In a basic or alkaline solution, we would get sulfate oxidation. The third important consideration is that in a strong acid environment, thiosulfate decomposes to sulfur. And lastly, in acidic environments, the iodide is oxidized to iodine, as shown in this reaction. An application of iodometric titration in environmental analysis is the determination of dissolved oxygen. Dissolved oxygen, or DO, is a measure of how much oxygen is dissolved in water, which means the amount of oxygen available for living aquatic organisms. The amount of dissolved oxygen in stream or lake can tell us a lot about its water quality. You can know more of dissolved oxygen by visiting this link in this slide. Now, the Winkler method is a technique used to measure dissolved oxygen in freshwater systems. This method uses iodometric titration to determine dissolved oxygen in water sample. You can find a demonstration video of this experiment in our course site. Let us now look at the chemistry involved in the Winkler method. In this method, divalent manganese solution is added to the water sample. This is then followed by the addition of a strong alkali in a glass stoppered bottle. The dissolved oxygen will rapidly oxidize an equivalent amount of the dispersed manganese hydroxide precipitates to hydroxides of higher valence states. In the next step, the presence of the iodide ions in an acidic solution will oxidize the manganese and will revert to its divalent state, which is Mn2+. This process is accompanied by the liberation of iodine that is equivalent to the original dissolved oxygen content. Now, the iodine is then titrated with a standard solution of thiosulfate. The titration endpoint can be detected visually using a starch indicator. Alright, so we shall see a typical problem using the Winkler method in the following slides. Okay, so for this problem, the level of dissolved oxygen in water sample is determined by the Winkler method. In a typical analysis, a 100 ml of the sample is made basic by the addition of sodium hydroxide and treated with solution of manganese sulfate, resulting in the formation of manganese dioxide. An excess of potassium iodide is added and the solution is acidified, resulting in the formation of manganese and iodine. The liberated iodine is titrated with a solution of 0.00870 molar sodium thiosulfate, requiring 8.90 mL to reach the starch indicator endpoint. Calculate the concentration of the dissolved oxygen as parts per million oxygen. So the reactions are also given in this slide. Alright, so before we start our calculations, let me just explain this following reactions. In the Winkler method, the manganese or the Mn2+ reacts with the oxygen or the dissolved oxygen to form manganese dioxide or MnO2, with manganese changing its oxidation state from positive 2 to positive 4, and each oxygen changing its oxidation state from 0 to negative 2. Thus, the first reaction tells us that each mole of oxygen gas reacts with 2 moles of the manganese or Mn2+. Subsequently, the MnO2 or the manganese dioxide reacts with iodide forming manganese, which is Mn2+, and triiodide, with manganese changing its oxidation state from positive 4 to positive 2. Thus, 3 moles of iodide it reacts with each mole of manganese dioxide. Finally, as what we have learned from this discussion, the titration of triiodide with thiosulfate, each mole of triiodide will react with 2 moles of thiosulfate. Alright, so we can determine the total moles of the thiosulfate that was used at the start of the titration. We can do this by multiplying the volume of the thiosulfate and the concentration of thiosulfate, and this will give us 7.74 times 10 raised to negative 5 moles of the thiosulfate. Using the stoichiometry that we have discussed earlier, we can relate the amount of the thiosulfate to the amount of the iodide. And from the amount of the iodide, we can relate this one to the amount of the manganese dioxide. And eventually, we can now calculate for the amount or the moles of oxygen as outlined in this simple dimensional analysis. Calculating the amount of oxygen in the original sample will give us 1.94 times 10 raised to negative 5 moles of oxygen. The mass of oxygen that is found in the original sample can be easily computed by multiplying 1.94 times 10 raised to negative 5 with the atomic mass of oxygen, which is 31.998 grams per mole. Now, this will give us 6.21 times 10 raised to negative 4 grams of oxygen. We can convert this one to micrograms and divide this with the sample volume, which is 100 ml, and this will give us 6.21 micrograms per ml of oxygen, or simply 6.21 ppm of oxygen as a dissolved oxygen content. The last type of redox titration that we will discuss in this lecture video is a titration involving bromine. These are called bromatometric titrations. In bromatometry, potassium bromate is used as a titrant. Potassium bromate is a strong oxidizing agent in acidic solution. In most cases, potassium bromate is used as titrant in the presence of bromide, as shown in this reaction. The oxidizing power is determined by the bromine-bromide system, which is equal to 1.08 volts. In this method, recrystallized potassium bromate can be used to prepare a standard solution of precisely known concentration. Potassium bromate solutions are known to be stable in air, and hydrochloric acid is often used to set the pH to the solution to acidic pH. Now, the solutions of potassium bromate can be standardized using primary standards such as arsenic oxide and sodium thiosulfate. Now, the reaction for the standardization is shown in this slide. Bromatometric titrations are commonly carried out in acidic solutions, as I've mentioned earlier, and the reaction rate can be increased by either heating the analyte solution or using a catalyst. Now, indicators are also needed in bromatometry. For example, methyl orange is an appropriate irreversible indicator dye in this method. The expected color change is from red to colorless. Another indicator dye is the paraetoxic chirosidine, which is a reversible redox indicator that changes color from red to orange. Bromatometry is often used to measure unsaturated organic compounds through addition or substitution reactions of bromine. Now, when we say unsaturated compounds, these are organic compounds containing double bonds. For example, 3 moles of bromine substitutes the 3 hydrogen atoms in the benzene ring of resorcinol, and the important reactions are shown in this slide. So these are the advantages of bromatometry. Bromatometry is not only used for the determination of oxidizers and reducers, but mainly for the determination of a lot of organic substances. We can also easily recrystallize potassium bromate, and we can use this recrystallized potassium bromate to prepare primary standard solutions of potassium bromate, and solutions of potassium bromate are stable. Similar to any other redox titrimetric methods, bromatometry also has its own disadvantages. Sometimes water, which forms in the reaction, interferes in the determination of many organic substances. And secondly, the oxidation of some organic substances is accompanied by hydrolysis, displacement, and addition reactions. Finally, to wrap up this lecture video about redox titrations, I have summarized the important points that you have to remember and consider in performing a redox titrations. So we have learned 5 representative methods such as permanganometry, iodometry, serimetry, bromatometry, and dichrometry. So we have also discussed the advantages and disadvantages of each type of redox titration. In general, redox titrations, you can apply this for a wide range of applications. So you can determine organic compounds, inorganic compounds, and ions. The disadvantage of redox titrations is that these methods have limited selectivity, limited stability of the titrants, and we can only detect to a certain concentration of the analyte. Now, the titrants are normally prepared from 0.01 to 0.1 molar solutions, and they typically need standardization. In terms of titration conditions, we learned that the analyte must have a single oxidation state before we carry out the titration, and we can use an auxiliary oxidizing agent or an auxiliary reducing agent to accomplish this task. Normally, we use the anacetic buffer to maintain the pH during the titration. Finally, just like any other titration that we have previously discussed, redox titration endpoints can be determined using indicators or by potentiometric method. Okay, so this lecture video completes the four types of titrimetric analysis. So we have already discussed acid-based titration, precipitation titration, complex formation titrations, and redox titration. Together with gravimetric methods, these techniques comprise the classical methods of analysis. Again, thank you for watching and see you in our synchronous session. Bye!